Today's episode of the Natural Habitat Podcast is brought to you by Dr. J's Rolling Trays. You don't know about Dr. J's Rolling Trays? Let me tell you all about it. Dr. J was a crazy old man. He thought that he made a cure for AIDS, but what he really did was made super AIDS. Remember you guys heard about that? And super gonorrhea? That was Dr. J. He went and he hid on an island away from people and he exiled himself. And he just started growing weed and trying to come up with the next cure for cancer. And in the meantime, a ship wrecked, the old wooden ship, and a bunch of it came and washed up on shore. He collected one piece of the wood and carved himself out a rolling tray for him to roll his joints. Now, while he was rolling and smoking these joints, the power of this wood gave him the cure for fucking AIDS, all right? You heard about the cure for HIV and AIDS? That's Dr. J. You can thank him because he did it with the power of a rolling tray, and you can get your own Dr. J's rolling tray at rollingtrays.com. Save 10% with the code NHP. Today, we have a very exciting interview. We have a cat named Zephyr. He's from the United Kingdom, and he is here to talk with us about his music. He's been producing stuff for a while, making some amazing tracks, and we also have an exclusive track from him that we are going to play today. I'm going to let you know right now, off the top, I'm going to be honest with you, it's at the end of the podcast, all right? So you can go there and listen to it if that's what you came here for, but that's just not, it's not really nice, you know? I wouldn't just skip to the end of your life and see how it ends. You know, I want to see that shit, I want to see it live through and see it come to fruition and know what I'm listening to, so listen to Zephyr, get to know him, and then you can hear this exclusive track. And if you are across the pond listening to us from the United Kingdom, we would like to welcome you. Thank you for joining us. We hope that you enjoy it. And we love you over here at Natural Habitat Podcast. So let's get into it with Zephyr right now.
The Natural Habitat Podcast.
Do we have a Christmas? It's not Christmas time yet, man. It's just December.
It's December.
It's not Christmas yet. It's December.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of different holidays that are going to come before Christmas.
Dude, we did Halloween the entire month of October.
That's because Halloween's amazing.
No.
All right.
We're going to do Christmas
today. Christmas is your Halloween. I forgot. Okay, fine. Yep. We're going to need a fucking Christmassy type smoke sesh song. I'm going to get something lined up. Don't worry about it. Thank you.
The Grinch.
That's what you want?
Yeah.
Consider it done, my friend. Welcome to the Natural Habitat Podcast, everybody. My name is Mikey.
My name is the Anti-Mikey.
That's right. And we are here to bring you some motherfucking Christmas cheer, bitch, because it's December 1st. It's December 1st. We have a guest here on the podcast. His name is Zephyr. He is from Bristol, which is in Great Britain, I believe, or the United Kingdom, something like that. Is that the same thing?
It's like a whole other country.
It's in a whole other country. It's across the pond is what it is. He is here joining us. It's his birthday, which is amazing. You know,
yeah, happy birthday, Zephyr. Shout out to you, buddy.
You only get one of those a year. And he has, you know, been making moves, been doing a lot of work with different artists. He produced a track for Varsity Dropouts called Wetter, which is available on multiple different SoundClouds. And, you know, he's just an all-around solid artist, good guy, and we're glad that we got a chance to chop it up with him. But right now, we're going to leave him on hold real fast and talk to you guys and just see how you guys are doing. You know, Thanksgiving happened. I hope everybody's still alive. There was a lot of poisonous turkeys out there. There was a guy that was driving around in a van handing out turkeys to poor people, and it turns out that they were all laced with strychnine. Did you hear about that?
I don't know.
Sounds you don't like know? Like you don't know if you heard about that? You think you'd remember.
Yeah. I know. I've been in a food coma, dude. All the fucking all the food we ate over the holidays, I'm still fucked up. I had to buy a new belt and shit, all kinds of shit.
Yeah, well, that's the price you pay for the holidays, man. So it's going to happen again.
It's a great price.
It's going to happen again in about 24 days.
I don't know about you, but there's not much more things I love to do more than eating. You know, I mean, good food is the best fucking thing ever. Good food and good weed, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you smoke good and then fucking eat good, your whole body just loves itself, you know what I mean? It's like,
it's an amazing, it's amazing,
amazing time of year, you know? It's full of good food and full of fucking everything. It's right after harvest season, so everybody's got their weed for their fucking winter hibernation and shit, you know what I mean? It's like, it's like, it's just a culmination of all the stress and all the shit from all year long, and just comes to an end and gets ready to start a new beginning. And you know, it's just like you get paid back for all the hard work and everything you put in, you know what I mean? And all your family comes together, everybody comes along. I mean, it's dope, dude. That's why it's my favorite time.
I'm excited, man, because There's no Christmas sweater better than a nice fat bong load or a big dab, and it gets you all sweaty, and that's a good feeling, because it sucks when it's hot summertime and you're taking dabs and sweating. Yep. Nobody likes that. So Christmas time, I think just for the cold, is dope. I love the cold. I'd rather be cold than hot, because you could always just bundle up, you know what I mean? And I love, I'm like a sweater guy. I love wearing sweaters and jackets. So that's really all I care about, is that I can wear a jacket. I don't really care about presents and stuff.
Yeah, I don't know. There's something magical about that day. You know, every year, something about Christmas Day that's like, the weather's always like kind of eerie, and you know what I mean? It just has its own feeling about it. You know what I mean? And we always talk about timing. You know what I mean? Timing is everything. And for some reason, that day, every year on the 25th of December, it's just like an eerie, odd feeling. The world like comes to a stop, and everybody's like celebrating, and you know what I mean? And it's like, it's crazy, man. It's an amazing time.
Fuck yeah. So we made it to another one. I'm glad. I didn't know if we were going to make it.
Yeah.
I thought we would both be dead by now.
Yeah, me fucking too, right? Mm-hmm. I never known, like, I never thought about being my age when I was younger, you know. I was like, wow, you know, like 30 seems so old. And now that I'm there, I feel so young. I feel like 17 still, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on? You know what I mean? Like, I don't know what's going on. I did not live up to any expectations that I thought I would as a kid, looking to see like what an adult would be like. You know what I mean? Like, I thought adulting was so much different. No, nobody really has a handle on it. Nobody knows what the fuck they're doing. Yeah. Everybody's just doing it. You know what I mean?
Everybody's just big kids. Everybody's just grown up kids. You start to realize that as you get older, you just see people that normally would be, you know, like a 40-year-old dude would be like an authority figure. He'd be able to, you know, go tell on you or call the cops or like grab or like grab you and hold you there, and you wouldn't be able to leave. But now it's like you just realize that he's just some fucking guy that you went to school with that is all grown up now, and he's just trying to do his own thing and trying to figure out his own life. It's a trip.
Yeah, pretty cool, man. I mean, it's funny. It's like redundant, you know. It's like we all had a way different outlook growing up. Like, we really thought grown-ups knew what they were doing. Turns out fucking nobody knows what they're doing. So shout out to all those fake grown-ups out there.
Right, everybody's just winging it.
Yeah, trying to act like we know what we're doing. We right. See you.
All right, so you wanna kick off this smoke sesh or what?
I've been known to a time or two.
Been known to our very first NHP smoke sesh of December.
Yeah,
that's a monumental
Merry Christmas,
thing.
Motherfuckers! Mm-hmm. Yeah,
everybody, pull out your Christmas trees and pack them up.
Yeah,
snap your pics.
I hope y'all ready for a ride too, because this can be a crazy month.
Yeah, it is. It is. We got a lot of shit lined up.
Yeah.
A lot of ideas. It's already mapped out pretty much the whole month. We just have to record it all. So it's gonna be great. All right.
Yeah.
You just wait and see. But until then, we're just gonna smoke right now, and then maybe get into this interview in a little bit. Zephyr is on the line. He can hear us, but we can't hear him. So I hope he hasn't been chiming in this whole time. That would be bad. Yep. Well, you know, I guess it's good. That's what everybody else does, I imagine. When people are in their car driving around listening to us, they probably are responding. And when I go, you know what, man, that's fucked up, they go, right?
Yeah. So let's see. Let's try it out right now. Raise your hand.
We both fucking raised our hand.
Well, maybe they did too. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I wonder how many people did it.
Air five. Ready? Boom.
Yep.
Air five. I hope you all air fived with us.
Damn right.
Now, and <that's, laughs> now pretend to smoke with us too.
That's the part of the podcast that's interactive right there.
Yeah. Boom. There you go.
All right. Well, we're going to get into it. Everybody, go ahead and fire it up. And if you can't smoke right now, if you're at work or you're doing something or you're with family or you got kids running around and you have your headphones on, then we will smoke with you.
Finger joints. Remember? Mm-hmm. Finger joint.
Just hit the finger joint. And it'll get you high, just the same. It's like a placebo effect. So Joey's going to start lighting up his nail. What happens is I'll start the music way too early, and then your nail won't be ready until the end of the smoke sesh.
Yeah, that's cool. Mm-hmm.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You've got garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39 and a half foot pole.
Whoa.
You're a vile one, Mr. Grinch. You have termites in your smile. You have all the tender sweetness of a seasick crocodile, Mr. Grinch. Given the choice between the two of you, I'd take the seasick crocodile.
Huh. What a strange, strange song. I don't know if
I know, but I feel like that's you. You're the Grinch. You're the Grinch who's trying to steal Christmas.
Am I?
You know, give it back to Halloween. Yeah, that's you.
Really? That's how you feel?
Yep.
So you you don't like to watch Nightmare Before Christmas then?
No, I do. I like it. I'm just fucking.
Because that's literally what that is. It's stealing Christmas and giving it back to Halloween. Because people watch that movie during Christmas, but it's all about Halloween. The whole thing is great.
Yeah. Don't want to ruin too much, but we're going to have a lot of great Christmas flicks for the Saturday matinees and maybe some extra subbed ones. Mm-hmm. We'll see what happens.
And it's like, I don't want to drop too many spoilies, but that's got to be one. The Nightmare Before Christmas, just because that shit was so huge in pop culture, dude. Like, it blew up everywhere. Still to this day,
it's one of those crossover things. It's for kids and adults.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And that's where a lot of these places really get it right.
Yep.
You know.
But we'll get into that. Like, that's a whole nother day, whole nother episode.
Yep.
But what I want to say is that, as you know, every day you get a little bit, you know, wiser, a little bit more keen to what things are happening and why things are happening, and you understand things a little bit more. So today, as a 29-year-old man, and I'm just super high, and I'm a little, you know, flustered because this is our, third podcast of the day. So I'm like in a zombie mode right now. And just the lyrics of that song were very, very strange to me for some reason. I never realized how weird they were. And it's just like, you know, what a strange direction to take that song.
Well, It comes from the old school, you know. Things were different back then. You know what I mean. Nothing was like out of reach or out of bounds, and
people were still trying.
You know what I mean. Everything wasn't all politically correct like it is now. So like people could do whatever they wanted to do and make weird shit and like make cool shit.
Yeah, it was definitely cool, and it was weird. I mean, I'm not saying it was bad. It was just very strange. I didn't know that it was that off the wall. You know what I mean? He said some weird shit in there. But
yeah.
Anyway, I'm going to try not to focus on it and let it not bother me. Do you want to go ahead and see if Zephyr's still on the line? Get into this interview?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, let's do it. All right, we have Zephyr live on the line. Can you hear me, brother?
I can indeed. Hello.
Hey, how are you? Thank you for joining us. We really appreciate you taking the time out of your day to be here and introduce yourself to our listeners. So thank you, man.
Hello. Hello, my name is Alex Chanel, otherwise known as Zephyr. I am a music producer from Bristol, England. I make a lot of music, I guess. I've got a lot of stuff lined up, and I kind of make music with the guidelines of future hip-hop, R&B, soul. It's pretty varied, but I do try and keep it grounded. Yeah, that's pretty much it. That's me, I guess.
Nice. So what do you think got you into music? Like, did you play instruments or anything? Or, like, what do you think was the catalyst that started your music career?
It's quite weird. I used to play electric guitar in a band, and then I kind of found electronic music by, I don't know how I found it, but I know what made me start making music on software, and it was this Sony Ericsson phone. It had a little toggle in the middle of the keypad, and it had this small little game app on it. And it was literally, you must have had about 8 loops that you could use. And I was just playing around with these loops. I was like, this is the dopest thing I've ever heard.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and then I ended up finding some other software online, Magic Music Maker. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's shit. But
yeah.
I ended up using that, and then FL Studio, and I haven't really changed then since. And yeah, I've just been doing it for absolutely ages now, and I've kind of just started to push on now.
Well, I'm glad you do, because the stuff that you're making is awesome.
Thanks, man. Hopefully you'll like this new song that's going to be released soon. It's got some promise.
Yeah, hell yeah. So, you know what's funny is it's not weird, honestly, that you started in a rock band, because almost every producer that we've interviewed so far has had the similar stories. Like, they started out playing an instrument or something like that, or in a rock band or whatever, and then it just led them into their path towards hip-hop or electronic music or whatever.
It seems to be across the board, every single one used to play in a band. And, you know, Joey and I are, we're hip-hop kids and rappers, and, you know, Joey's into, like, the EDM hybrid side of it, and we come from this history of, you know, you grow up, you listen to a guy rap, and you go, I want to do that, and then you start writing. There really isn't this band stage before it, and it seems like all good producers that are making quality music know this structure of music and playing music with people, putting it together, and have fucked with it for a while. So, you know, that's not surprising at all. I think it pays off, and it shows in your music. A lot of us have heard your track Wetter that you did with you produced for Varsity Dropouts, and that track is just phenomenal. You schooled it, man. That track is amazing. I was just listening to it this morning. Thanks, so it definitely shows.
Oh, that's nice to hear. It's nice to hear that people listen to your songs, even from overseas as well.
Most definitely.
It is nice. It got on Rap City as well, which is pretty cool, and then Trap City uploaded another song of mine, which is even cooler, because it was just Rap City, Trap City, and then, kind of got pretty good. But you're right about how it's weird, because I've seen, like, a pattern with how people do get into music, and it's either people go vocally and they get into rap or emceeing or becoming, like, a hype man at shows and then end up coming real good, or then people start with instruments. It's quite weird.
So I'm curious, like, In the last year and a half, we've stepped out of our hip hop realm into the electronic world. And so far, what we've noticed is a lot of love and a lot of willingness and eagerness to collaborate and work with others. And so my question is it as competitive across the pond as it is here? Like, Or do you see that same kind of, like, willingness to work with others?
People, it's hard to kind of look at it. I think in America, it's a lot more competitive, if I'm honest. When it comes to EDM kind of rap, it's... In fact, America are probably pushing it a lot more than the UK, but the UK are trying to, are starting to hop on it now. I'm working with a rapper at the moment who is doing a lot like doing stuff a lot like Varsity Dropouts, and but he's probably the only person that I can think of. He's called D-Dark. I don't know whether you know him.
Yeah, he's awesome.
He's pretty damn good as well, but he's literally the only person I can think of in the UK that actually do what Varsity Dropouts are doing. But I think the way that America are pushing it at the moment, it should catch on quite quickly. It's probably the two of the strongest genres that I listen to mixed into one. You can't really go wrong.
Right? Yeah, that's exactly how I feel about it too. I feel like it's the future. It's inevitable. You know what I mean? Like, it's bound to happen no matter what. So that's cool to see that you guys have the same type of influences. And congratulations on the D-Dark thing. We'd love to work with him too. He's fucking awesome.
Yeah, thanks.
And like you said, there is only a few of us that are doing that trap rap thing, you know what I mean? And it's so new that we're even coming across problems, like we're having problems getting songs places because we're either too rap for the trap genre or too trap for the rap genre, you know what I mean? So it's like it's like a fucking bubble that we're trapped in. But so
you've got to push it, and it's a small market, but it means once you get there, you get there, and you'll be known for your sound, and that it's a blessing in disguise, really.
Yeah. So there's a lot of talented people over there. Troy Boy is one of the biggest artists probably out of the UK right now. Definitely. And I feel like he's the next Dr. Dre. I feel like he's like the electronic Dr. Dre.
I think he's definitely going to be there soon. He's getting gigs left, right, and center. Everybody loves his. I don't think I know anybody that dislikes his music.
Yeah,
he has like four different genres in one song, and you just can't really go wrong. It's so good. He's really strong. Other people in the UK, Stucky Sound are doing really good. They're the kind of people that I could imagine you hopping on a beat with.
Yeah.
They're pushing real good. In fact, I think Troy Boy and Stucky have done a track together. But Troy Boy's really pushing it. He does remind me a lot like Dr. Dre as well. He's got the hip hop drums. It's real strong stuff that he makes.
So for you being an up and coming artist, what's the likelihood of you being able to work with people that are already established? Like, say, you, Zephyr, wanted to reach out and work with Troy Boy. How feasible is a connection like that to happen? Like, do you think that people show you love because you're in the industry? Or do you think that it's just as hard as anything else? Like, it's a money thing or what? How does it work?
Recently, I have realized that it is about who you know. You could send out, you could get your manager to send out an email and hope for the best, but it either depends on a one hit track that he comes across by luck, or you end up meeting him at a show, or you have connections towards him.
Yeah,
I think a lot of the time, producers potentially do have the talent to work with someone like Troy Boy. It really is just trying to get your sound to him, so he can find time to actually do it. Right. Personally, at the moment, I don't think I could work with him purely because of that bottleneck. But maybe in the future, that would be so fucking sick.
I mean, collaborations are key in everything, really.
They really are, yeah. And he gets he gets millions of views now. I mean, he's doubled following in a few months recently. He's doing really well, but I can't imagine how busy he is right now, and just someone coming through going, "Hey, yo, man, want to collab?" When you got 4,000 followers,
right?
he's probably getting people hitting him up all the time for collabs, which is the hard thing. It's just because there's an oversaturation of producers and artists. You know, it's an interesting time that we live in with the technology and how everybody has a supercomputer that can do more than the space station in their pocket, and we can all talk to each other. I mean, we're having a podcast right now, and we're all in different places around the world, and we're all having a discussion in live time, and there's no barriers anymore. There's no countries or, you know, states, and it's just the world, and we could all communicate with each other. But the downside of that is that everybody can communicate, and not everybody's music is that great. So a lot of people are getting stuff pushed on them constantly.
The bottleneck in the old days was finding the techniques and the help to get to that point where you're a good producer. Now it's easier to become a good producer, but harder to get involved with the people that you need to get involved with, purely because it's so saturated now. And this is why EDM rap, for example, will do so well is because it's so new and nobody does it, or there's a small handful of people that do it.
Yep.
And so it sounds to me like you have the same type of things going on as we do. It's like everything's really clicky. You know, like certain groups stays with groups and other groups stay with their own groups and they don't like kind of intermingle. Like everybody's got their own direction that they're headed towards, you know what I mean? So where's Zephyr's direction? What is your what's your biggest accolades and accomplishments so far, and where do you see yourself going towards in the future?
Good question. I try and incorporate a lot of hip hop and R&B into my stuff because I want to eventually produce for rappers and artists, mainly in the American industry and probably the UK as well. My major accomplishments at the moment have got to be the uploads on YouTube, obtaining a manager. My first single got premiered on BBC One and Radio One Extra.
Hey, and that's awesome. That shit's even big over here, dude. I know it probably didn't seem like it, but BBC One is a huge outlet for music regardless. It doesn't matter. There's no borders, like we said. You know, it doesn't matter what's happening over here. Or over there, you know, it's like we notice that shit. We see it all.
And everything's online now.
It's definitely a big accomplishment.
Yeah, it is good. I guess I wouldn't say that I've actually hit many of my targets yet. It's really just starting to happen now. But I would like to see myself in a couple of years producing for artists, but also having a side project of me DJing and touring and earning money that way. Because at the end of the day, we all want to sustain a living on music, don't we? And
most definitely.
Yeah, we don't want to live in an office all our lives.
So what are your other influences outside of music? Like, my favorite TV show in the world right now is Top Gear. Has been for a long time, and I'm like uber excited about what's going to happen, like what the new show is going to be like, and
I'm a fan of Jeremy Clarkson. I don't care what anybody says.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so are we.
He's a genius. Yeah,
team Jeremy, definitely. It's hard to think. I'm sure you probably know about this TV show, but Blue Mountain State. It's probably one of my favorite shows on earth. There's loads. I'm more of a film kind of guy. I'm absolute film.
Well, so are we. We do a thing called Saturday Matinees where we discuss movies that we like every Saturday.
That's cool. I like a lot of films, like a lot of different films, like Under the Skin. A lot of people would see that as a boring film, but it fucked me for a long time. Memento. I like the Inceptions and the Interstellars and stuff like that.
Yeah,
Interstellars.
I saw the Martian like literally a couple of days ago, which I thought was quality as well.
Yeah,
I heard that's supposed to be really good. Actually,
it is really fucking good. I still think Interstellar is probably the best there.
What about zombies and like things like that?
Yeah, I used to be a big fan of zombies, zombie films. But I think I kind of. Have you ever seen a film called Stakeland before?
No, I can't say that.
That sounds familiar.
It's on Netflix. You've probably seen it on Netflix somewhere. It's so dope. I think. But after Zombieland, I kind of went off it because I think Zombieland pretty much nailed the genre.
Right.
Or Shaun of the Dead as well. That's kind of like our version of Zombieland.
That one. All everything they do together is amazing too. Nick Frost and Simon Pegg are the shit.
Literally, they are so good.
See, it's so funny. Like, there is a huge disconnect between here and there, but there really isn't. We like a lot of the same things. We find the same things interesting and funny. We make the similar types of music. You know what I mean? Like, we have so much in common.
Yeah.
It's strange how people say that English have a dry sense of humor, but Americans love The Office, which is like the most dry. We've even made their own series of it, and it's probably better than the original. I absolutely love the American Office. It's so much better.
and I feel like that it's a mutual thing too, because we like things that are different. Like the Inbetweeners, I think is hilarious. I don't think a lot of people out here really know about it. So
Didn't they attempt an American Inbetweeners? I'm not sure how that went down, but
the only ones I've seen is just the British ones and the movies. I saw the regular seasons and then the movies.
Yeah, I haven't seen the second one yet, but I need to see it. The first one was so good.
They're all fucking hilarious. So that's cool to see. What about weed? We're super huge marijuana advocates, and we have a smoke session on every episode. And we definitely are champions for the cause. And
yeah,
what's it like?
What are the weed laws
there? What's
like?
The laws?
It's pretty good over in America at the moment, but it's also pretty good in certain parts of the UK. In Bristol, my hometown, it's almost legal. You can smoke weed down the high street, even though, you know, if police caught you, they'd probably take it off you. But it's almost legal there. I smoked weed for like 4 years, and I quit for 4 years, and then I went to Amsterdam and started again. But I'm a big supporter of weed. It should be legal. 100% should be legal.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I saw you hit a bong as well. I love that.
Speaking of, that's how it was.
What's that?
I was gonna say, where do you guys live? Like, do you get it?
We live in California.
Distantly, or?
We live in California. Right now, it is medicinally, but it's on the ballot for this year's vote to make it recreational. And if that passes, it'll be legal for everybody, whether you have a medical card or not.
Yeah. That is so good. Are you? I don't know why I'm interviewing you, but are you a supporter of Bernie?
Oh yeah, most definitely. Yeah.
Didn't he say that he wanted to legalize marijuana recently as well?
Yeah, he said he wants to decriminalize it. Well, not decriminalize it, but he said he wants to take it off the federal drug list and make it not a drug at all.
So you can't get prosecuted for it.
Yeah, well, you can't do anything about it. They can't charge you. It won't be classified as a drug anymore. Mm.
Yeah,
there's obviously reasons why they wouldn't do that, though, because of conspiracies and how easy.
Well, I think it's mostly because they haven't figured out how to make money off it, and now it's like they could tax it like they do alcohol, but it's still, I mean, it's going to bring in money, but it's not going to be, they're not going to be in control of it like they'd like to be. They've let it get out of hand to the point now where there's so many people who grow it themselves. There's so many up-and-coming businesses that are growing it and transforming the industry right now that the government's too far behind to take control anymore. You know what I mean? So they're in a shitty place where it's like damned if you do, damned if you don't type of thing. You know what I mean? Like if they legalize it now, they won't be able to control it.
Yeah, because
that's the last thing they're holding on to.
They would want to make it like a cash crop, like tobacco, like how you can't grow tobacco in your backyard. They would make it how you can't grow weed anywhere, and then all the weed would be watered down, and you'd have to buy, you know, Marlboro packs of joints that you have to smoke three or four to get high. So
they'd have loads of chemicals in sure as well.
Yeah, we don't want that to happen. I would rather just medical weed forever now that I have my card. Because before I had my card, it was like how it is there. You know, the cops pull you over, they take your weed. Sometimes they don't take your weed and they're just like, leave this at home. And that's about it, you know? It's no big deal.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. Not to get too off topic and not to switch everything up, but really what it all boils down to is whose business is it of theirs or anybody else to tell you what to do with your body?
Yep.
You know what I mean? And that's the only dilemma and the only issue that should matter. It shouldn't be about taxes or money or jail time or anything. It shouldn't be about anything except for who are you to tell me what I can do with my body, period. You shouldn't.
As long as you're not harming anybody else, so they shouldn't really complain.
Exactly. And that falls under all drugs, not just marijuana. You know what I mean? Yeah. It doesn't matter. Like if you look at places that legalized all drugs, They're all better off for it, you know.
There's less crime rates in Amsterdam, Portugal.
Yeah, the evidence is in the numbers. So
yeah, definitely. I mean,
so that's cool, man. It's refreshing to me to see that you have a lot of the same views as us. Mm. You are into a lot of the same things as us. You know, we can relate so readily offhand, and we've never even spoken before. Honestly, it's been all internet connection, you know what I mean? And and that to me is surprising in itself, but not really, because I somewhat expected it. I'm like more into British culture a lot more than most people around here, but that being aside from it, it's just nice to know that there isn't a boundary between us, you know what I mean? It's cool to see that we're all on the same page. I'm sure it's cool for the listeners out there to see, like, wow, you know, people have different people have real misconceptions of like alternate realities. Like, oh, I wonder how people live in this other place, or I wonder how they do things over there. Well, it's not much different at time, apart from like a time difference. And I mean, social norms, like, you know, like British humor for one, you guys have like, you guys have your own things, sayings, words and things that you use in place of other things. So us over here, you don't get it unless you like listen to it a lot or like are caught up with it. You know what I mean? But you guys have little sayings that people don't get over here. And I'm sure that I'm sure it's vice versa as well.
That makes me, that makes me think
a lot of,
you should lay us out some things that we might not know, like some British sayings that that you say.
This is really weird because I was trying to think of this recently, and it's so hard to come up with things. Let me think. I live with a guy that lives in a place called Leicester, and he eats something called a cob. Do you know what a cob is?
Like corn?
Nope. That'd be the obvious answer.
Nope.
It's actually just a bread bun, but I have no idea. We don't even call it cob in anywhere else in the country apart from Leicester, which I find quite weird. But in America, America words are coming over here. They're like definitely being taken over. Dope is like all over England now. Dope was not a dope word, but I think dope is a dope word now.
That's dope.
Yeah, that is. But yeah, so I can't really think of. I actually saw a video as well on the internet about what people thought words were, and American people about English words, and it was so funny, but I can't think of any words.
They were all just like me, all like corn.
Boston Steamer or whatever, that's what they said, or like...
I have never heard that before. Is that an American thing?
Yeah, it's like where somebody shits on your chest or something like that.
Oh, we call that a steamroller.
Yeah.
They just rub it in with their butts.
Yeah, see? So it's like funny slang term. So funny.
Oh,
like, I think I was referring even to like a lot of stuff that's out of date, like a man about a dog. You know what I mean? Like how many people still say that?
Oh, not many, I don't think.
Yeah, see, and that's where the disconnect is.
What the hell does
that
mean?
The things that we think of is like from generations past, you know? Like, that's probably one, maybe even two generations before your time.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're just remembering stuff from old school movies. A thing about a guy about a dog, what would you say?
A man about a dog,
what is that?
And things like that. There's like...
That's the apocalyptic film, isn't it? Apocalyptic film, isn't it?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, doesn't it mean you gotta go take a shit or something?
I have no idea. A man without a dog. We in England we say that we need to drop the kids off at the pool.
Oh yeah, that's a thing here too.
Yeah, and bomb China as well.
Nice.
I'm trying to think. I'm literally looking at Google now, trying to find phrases that you won't understand. I'm gonna put you to the test. Right. No, none of these are going to work. Absolutely none of them. Give up. But yeah, no, we've got some words that you probably don't understand as you do, that I won't understand.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, why is your money different? Like, you have two different names for the dollar.
Oh, yeah, we call it coin, money, P. I don't know why we call it P, but we call it P.
And that's for, like, what, for change?
That's just in general money. P, coin, we call it dollar. We actually call it dollar sometimes. Green, you probably call it green, I guess. Because you got green notes, so you must call it green.
Yeah.
Stacks, oh, that's American. I'm just saying shit now. But yeah, we got a couple of names. But our money system is quite weird as well, to be honest.
Yeah, it is. Like, but it's got their shit together more than ours.
Yeah, our money doesn't mean anything. So
at least the strength of the currency. Yeah,
that's funny. So between the similarities and differences, it's pretty cool to see that you guys are the same as us. You know, you have the same visions, you have the same aspirations and goals and desires. I mean, and that's to be expected. I feel like people are people. It doesn't matter where the fuck you're from. You know, people are going to have the same wants and everything. So, pretty dope, dude. It's cool talking to you, dude. It's cool seeing, like, you know, like, we do have the same outlooks. I'm sure that you're hoping for the same things we are, that, you know, people take the time out when they see the links and give us a listen and you know what I mean? And us being artists, we appreciate the feedback, you know what I mean? And we like any interaction, we get excited and we get to see people actually like take it serious. So
like a message on SoundCloud, you should see me in my room. I'm just like,
yeah, right?
Right. Yeah.
Big smile, like all fucking ear to ear grin, like super amped on everything. You know, it's cool to see when people take notice and you have songs that become popular. There's no better feeling than it makes you feel like the work that you put in and that you struggled to get to is paying off, right?
It really is. It's the best buzz. It's what I really work for now. I don't really work for anything but the buzz at the moment. And it is probably the best feeling around.
Yeah.
I guess in like other jobs, you get certain buzzes for other reasons. But from what I've experienced, it is probably the best buzz. People just commenting saying that, oh, I love Zephyr right now. Like, that's good to know that people don't just like one song. They like me as an artist. And it's good.
Yeah, and there's no greater feeling than recognition, really. I mean, it's awesome to see, like, I don't remember how many years you said you're making music now?
Sorry? 5 years, maybe? 6 years, maybe?
Yeah, and to be, like, so 6 years deep and to just now be getting that recognition is it's a struggle going through that time, but fuck, the payoff was so worth it.
You know? Yeah, that's the thing. When, like, nowadays, you get like super producers at the age of like 14 because they start young. I started at the age of, it must have been, I was 17, so it's been 5 years. And I didn't have anybody I didn't have a collective that I was in where I could talk to people. Right. I was just completely on my own for like 2 or 3 years just making shitty R&B beats. But
and see, I feel like these kids that are getting these breaks, mm-hmm. it's not just talent based alone. It's because that they're like we said, they're finding people, they're meeting the right people that's putting them in the right positions.
Yep. Now it's who you know,
other
and
people
who you
like
blow.
Us. Yeah, other people like us that don't have those connections, all we can do is just keep doing it. Keep progressing, keep getting better. Practice makes perfect. Constant repetition is the path to progression. You know what I'm saying? Like that's the only way to do it. And so for other artists out there that feel like, fuck, I've been doing this for 5, 10, 15 years even, you know, and still haven't got that break, don't give up. You know what I mean? Like if you're good at it and you have a passion and you know that that's what you want to do or what you're supposed to do, then keep doing it. You know what I mean? Like, so not everybody's going to be that overnight celebrity or overnight superstar. That doesn't happen to anybody, really. Like, the small percentage of people that happens to is fucking almost non-existent compared to, like, the real artists that are out there, you know? Like, I honestly feel that the best artists haven't been found yet, you know? The best artists to ever exist probably never get found, you know, and that's the sad part of it. There's 7 billion people here. You gotta think that a fucking million or two are just uber fucking ridiculously talented and have no way to get found yet. So
and they'll never be seen, probably most of them.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So
I'm sort of thank the internet.
Yeah, most definitely. We get to be an inspiration to others. So I just want to say shout out to you for doing what you're doing. I think you are an inspiration to others. I think you're an inspiration to people locally and even internationally. I feel like you gotta keep pushing. You got a cool sound. I feel like people are loving your music and are gonna get to know it a lot more and love it a lot more. And I feel like we're all making steps towards the right future, and I hope that people take notes and take some inspiration from it and are as excited as we are.
Yep.
Yeah, man, definitely. Same back to you. It's looking promising. It's good. Because I remember when we first hooked up for the collaboration, I must have been hitting like 5K views on a track at most, and I was like, this isn't good enough. And then when you came along, I was like, I've got to do this, because you were getting mad plays both on your own channels and then with Varsity Dropouts, and it really was my way in, to be honest. And then ever since it's kicked off, so I got to thank you for that. So thanks for that.
Yeah, well, thank you, dude. I mean, it's all about those collaborations. It's all about the network. We're cementing our own future, and nobody else is doing that for us. You know what I mean? So
it's
not for no reason. Just know that
there's enough artists out here now that, you know, don't know the right people and can't go through the back door into the music industry and are building their own grassroots and their own following and, you know, people that are going to follow their whole career instead of just come in and out. And, you know, there's enough people there on SoundCloud is a big platform for artists, and, you know, you can help each other out and, You know, fan sharing is one of the most important things that artists can do, because if you're an artist and if you stand behind someone else's music that you're collaborating with and you like it, you enjoy it, then, you know, you tell your fans, hey, check out this guy. You'll like him. And then that guy goes, hey, I did a song with this guy. He's really good. And then all of these people that like the same kind of music will be exposed to something they already like. And that's more powerful than any magazine placement or billboard or anything, you know?
More powerful and more reach than those fucking posts you can pay for on Facebook.
Yep.
More powerful and more reach organically than you can buy with your fake followers and what, fake fucking settings.
And what that is, you know, like, what I mean? Like right there, that little deal and agreement that people are working together and sharing their fans and using this platform, that's ambitious artists using the technology of today the best they can. And I think that's really the best route to go down. You guys are doing it right. And you're going to do nothing but grow from here. You know what I mean? So I think your music's dope, man. Keep it up.
Thanks, man. One of the biggest issues that I had to get past was people would want to collaborate. And this probably stalled my progress for quite a while. And people would go, yo, man, do you want to collaborate? And I'd say, I'd be like, okay, he's got more followers than me. I'd definitely be down for a collaboration. And I'd go through my songs and I'd be like, I want to keep these to myself. But if that was advice to give, I would just say, don't hold your music back. If there's someone with more followers who wants to make a good song with you and you've got a project that you can send to them, send it away, because they're going to push on for you.
Right. I agree.
I was always too selfish with holding back. I wanted to take the glory for my song, but I've changed completely now. My latest song, I did a collaboration with my new housemate because I've just moved to uni. That's got like 15,000 views in 3 days, and I probably wouldn't have even started that track had he had not sent it over and done what I didn't used to do. He was he threw away a banger and gave it to me, and we made it even better. So it's always about sharing and being nice, and just don't be selfish when it comes to music. Right. Spread the web, basically.
Right, because, you know, like, gaining something in the moment means nothing in the long term. You know what I mean? It's like building those relationships and working with people and doing it for the music is always going to stand out. It's always going to speak for itself, you know? Yeah. It's like when you try to force things, it's obvious. When you do things and make it about the music, that's obvious too. When you care about it and you just do the right thing and you just do shit, it comes out good and how it's supposed to be, and it just like grows and it catches a buzz. And other times when you like try to force it because like it's in the moment and you just want to make that hit or get that money or whatever it is, and then it fucks up relationships and like, you know what I mean? It's like, it's fickle. It's a fickle industry, but you're absolutely right, dude. It's like,
don't. And never shy away from favors either. Always do favors.
Yeah.
Come back to you and the links will never sever as long as you're nice. And the links are the most important thing.
Right. It really is a community. You know what I mean? Yes. Like we're all in the same industry / community, whether you're on a major label or whether you're completely independent with no help from anybody. It's like we're all learning how to run these channels together. You know what I mean? So
definitely.
Well, smart man, sound like you got your head on your shoulders, dude. You're gonna go far. I feel like you're gonna be super successful, and
fucking hope so.
we're just glad to be a part of it.
Thanks, man. Yeah, we'll definitely have to hit up a collab in the new year as well.
Most definitely.
That'd be so dope.
So 2016. So before we go, do you have anything coming up that you're going to be releasing soon or that you're working on that you could tell us about?
The collaboration with D-Dark has got a G-Funk kind of vibe, so hopefully you'll like that. It's a very American influence, but I absolutely love G-Funk at the moment. So what else? The song that's going to be played, that's a collaboration with a university student that I work with. That's going to be sent off to the A&Rs at Sony, MTA Records, Universal.
Nice, man.
Links in there. So hopefully I might get a single signed to there. If not, I'll just push on with online and have an exclusive with Trap Nation, which would be dope because that would then push the followers up a little bit more.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm just going to continue just making consistent bangers, hopefully.
And, yeah, fuck yeah.
That's dope.
That's
man.
Pretty much it.
Whenever you're dropping stuff, let us know, and we'll play stuff on upcoming shows or help promote and stuff. We'll do what we can. I know that, you know, you got another couple thousand people that are more intimate with you now, know a little bit more about you.
Yeah.
If they didn't know about you before, now they do. So,
this is all just came from Locke's chatbox messaging me on SoundCloud. So it is all about just linking up and chatting. So it's good.
Yeah. Well, thank you for joining us, man. We really appreciate it.
No worries. Thank you very much.
All right, man. It was great to meet you.
Cheers, guys. Right. Speak to you soon. Thank you.
Easy.
All right, man. Well, that went really fucking good.
Yeah.
He was definitely an interesting dude. It was nice to chop it up with him. I'm glad that he stayed on hold.
Yeah, Zephyr's the shit, dude, really. I mean, he's like really new in the game still. You know what I mean? Like relatively new, and he's growing super fast. So it's cool to see you actually get to see the entire progression of him as an artist. You know what I mean? Like all of his shit recently up until now, you know what I mean, is just like his trail of progression, you know, and everything he's doing right now is dope. Everything's getting like a lot of love. He's working with like a lot of people helping him get his shit out there and like different collectives and things like that. So like he's really doing it,
you know? Yeah.
And it's cool to see like buddy doing the same thing we're doing.
Right.
Just fucking another country, you know?
So just one question I heard while you were going over that excessive panting in the background, that wasn't coming from me. Is Judith inside your apartment again?
No, Judith.
What's going on?
I'm watching the neighbor's dog. But no Judith.
Oh, all right. You need to tell that dog to calm down because he's trying to be a star and he's trying to jump in the conversation and, you know, put in his two cents. And he needs to schedule an appointment to be on the show, all right? We have people lined up that we're trying to get to, so we can't just get to this dog. What's his name?
Can't tell you. It's a secret.
what kind of fucking dog is this?
It's a special dog.
Special needs dog. All right. So that's dope that Zephyr joined us. I think that he had a lot of insight and, you know, he knows what he wants to do with his music and with his career, and it's going to be good to watch him grow. So everybody go and follow him right now on SoundCloud, Facebook, wherever people follow people, and we'll put the links in the description so you can find him there and give him a follow and join the journey. You know what I'm saying? That fucking dog. This anonymous dog that doesn't have a name. He's like some sort of special agent dog.
That's so funny.
All right. Well, December.
Hey, dogs do podcasts too.
That's right. December's going to be fun. We have a new co-host with us. It's this dog. Yep. This dog's going to be here. Yep. And
it doesn't make noise. It just sits here.
He just pants when things get intense. Yeah. You know what I mean? Or it's when he lets us know that we need to move it along. Moving along, guys. Yeah. You're just kind of sitting around. So when you hear the panting, that means it's time to go. It's like a gong. So
he's over it. He's out. I'm over it.
He's laying down. He's done.
Like, fuck you guys. Mm-hmm. And your podcast.
He's still going to look at us and pant, though.
Yeah.
All right, well, thank you for joining us, everybody. I hope that your December is filled with Christmas cheer and little to no rape or molestation.
Yeah.
What about you? You got a thing to say?
Nope.
All right. Bye, everybody.
Peace, bitches.
Girl, I love the way you put it down. talk about it, man, you'll see that I like it, that you like it. Oh, we love it. It's just see for me. When I talk about it, make you see that you want it, and I want it. Oh, I want it, baby. Some time with me, oh, oh.